Okay, so our body is human cells, and then you've got this ecosystem of bacteria and archaea and viruses and protozoa. And the most critical moment for our microbiome, our human microbiome, is birth. The positive benefits of vaginal birth, where possible, skin to skin and breastfeeding. That baby is not getting any microbes, only those special microbes from the mother. Vaginal birth could switch on or switch off certain genes. So our next film is looking at what you can do to protect and maintain your microbiome from birth throughout life. Hello, I'm Toni Harman. I'm a filmmaker and I make films with Alex Wakeford, who's sitting over there with my daughter, Willow. So first of all, thank you for the World Foundation for Natural Science for inviting me here, to Kirsten Propp for asking us to be here, and thank you to our grandparents, actually, and particularly our grandmothers, because as I'll tell you in a little while, it's kind of what our grandmothers ate, how they lived, and how they gave birth affects who we are and our health now. So thank you to us, but also our grandparents. Okay, so who am I? I'm a filmmaker, I'm a mother, and I met Alex 20 years ago at film school, and we started making factual programs. We made a feature film, a horror film, that got picked up by a Hollywood studio. And then we had a child, daughter, Willow, and we started making documentaries about birth. So we've made a documentary called Doula, about doulas. I made a film about human rights in childbirth called Freedom for Birth. And then in making Freedom for Birth, we're talking to various academics and scientists and lawyers, actually. And one of the things that people started talking about was the microbiome. And we'd never heard this word before. And so we started looking into it, about what is the microbiome and how it's impacted by the way we give birth. And we suddenly realized there's a story to be told. And actually, the way we are born and the way we are fed in the first few days, weeks, months, even years, that there could be long-term health consequences later in life. And so we made a film called Microbirth that we released last year. And I think, I'm not sure if a clip was shown here, but it was. I know that Kirsten talked about Microbirth last year, and now we're here. And so Microbirth was released in September last year, and it won the Grand Prix Award at the Life Sciences Film Festival in Prague, and is now being shown internationally. And it's raised awareness of what I'm going to talk about today, about the seeding and feeding of the baby's microbiome. Okay, to set the scene, I'm going to play a clip of the first few minutes of the film, so you just kind of get a feeling of what the film's about.
We think we're at the pinnacle of our existence, and yet the reality is we've never been sicker.
We have been facing a rising epidemic of plagues, from asthma to obesity to allergic diseases.
And it's going to get worse.
Tomorrow's generation really is on the edge of the precipice.
We're bankrupting ourselves.
The cost would reach a staggering $47 trillion.
That's not sustainable. We're hitting the wall right now.
Let's say you have 10 diseases that are rising at the same time. Perhaps there's one thing that's fueling them all. Our ancient microbiome, which protected us against many diseases, is degrading.
We estimate we have lost about a third of the diversity of our microbes.
If we miss the window at birth, then the immune system never matures correctly.
If you upset this process in the early life, then we may have consequences later.
And that can lead to production of disease later in life.
I think we're in the midst of the largest experiment in human history.
Humanity is heading for a huge health crisis.
Worst case scenario is, in fact, really terrible. We have to alert the public.
I don't think we're too late, but we're definitely not too early either.
Turn the microscope on birth. It's a really important part of a human being's life.
We can make a significant impact on health for all mankind.
If how we're born affects our chances of long-term health, we need to seize this opportunity to actually turn the course of human health.
If we don't take the bigger perspective, how do we know that we're not altering the course of humanity?
Okay, so to make Microbirth, we interviewed 12 leading professors from all around the world. So in that clip there, we saw Professor Rodney Dirtet, who's Professor of Immunotoxicology from Cornell University. You also saw Martin Blaser, who is the Director of the Human Microbiome Program at New York University. And we filmed 12 just different fields, from immunotoxicologists to microbiologists to midwives to professors of obstetrics to professors of neonatal medicine, even a professor of economics. So we wanted to find out what's the latest thinking and what's the latest science about the microbiome and birth. Okay, so in this talk and in the film, I use the words could and possibly, potentially, and it's a hypothesis. This is because this science is emerging, and within the next, 5, 10, 20 years, even 50 years, we might have more definite proof. But as the scientists told us, it's very difficult to get definite proof that these things are happening, because firstly, you can't experiment on women giving birth, for obvious reasons. Most of the research so far has been on mouse studies or other animal studies. One of the professors we interviewed, Professor Sue Carter, who's a biologist and behavioral neurobiologist, she researches on prairie voles because there's something within prairie voles that reflects and mimics human birth. So so the studies so far have mostly been on mouse studies, and I'm not a scientist, but the scientists tell me that to do experiments on animals, you have to get through ethics committee. And with ethics committee, they only approve, or they tend to approve, one test being done on an animal. So it might be to see how the exposure of synthetic oxytocin to an animal during birth. And synthetic oxytocin is something that's used to, I'm a midwife, but sometimes used to induce labor or to speed up contractions. It can also be used to try to stop excessive bleeding after birth. Okay, so in mouse models, they found that they use synthetic oxytocin and they're seeing the long-term effects. But in most hospitals around the world today, particularly in developed world, I should say, most women have at least one, if not multiple, interventions happening in birth. So that could be use of synthetic oxytocin, it could be use of an epidural, it could be forceps, it could be a caesarean section, it could be any other number of things happening that sometimes happen, which is the cascade of interventions that happen. Yet, there's no science or very little large-scale published research on these multiple interventions happening every day all across, the developed world. And there's another thing, that the research has been focused on the short-term effects. So the short-term effects of maybe synthetic oxytocin use in birth, or the short-term effects of epidurals. Because it takes time, money, motivation, just the long-term effects of these multiple interventions haven't been researched across across humans, it just hasn't been researched. So someone like Professor Sue Carter, who is this biologist and neurobehavioral neurobiologist, she says, and I quote directly from her from the film, we are in the midst of the largest experiment in human history. Because we don't know. We've got the early stage research, which we talked about in the film, but in terms of conclusive evidence, that's further down the line. Okay, so why do these scientists that we filmed, why do we think that birth is so important? I'm going to play a clip, and then I'll talk about it. So, clip two, please.
Scientists have recently embarked on a new journey of discovery. A journey that takes us through the lens of a microscope to discover who we really are and how a species could get so sick so fast. Life at its healthiest exists as an ecosystem, a diversity of species that coexist, that live in harmony, that live in balance. But when the harmony is disturbed and the balance is upset, or when that diversity of species is reduced, the ecosystem may become vulnerable to disease and could even die.
If you remove half of the types of trees in a very diverse forest, it doesn't stay the same for the rest of the trees that are there. There's extra space, the dynamics of the interactions are completely changed, and the entire forest takes on a totally different flavor, and in some cases, a very unpredictable flavor.
This can happen in a local ecosystem. It can happen at a planetary level, but it can also happen at the micro level. It can even happen within us, because we are a walking ecosystem. The human body is host to trillions of microbes. They outnumber our human cells by an astonishing ratio of 10 to 1.
So it's estimated that we have about 10 trillion human cells in our body. And the current estimate is that we have about 100 trillion microbes living in our body. And that's how it is every day of our life.
We're 90% microbial and only 10% mammalian. The microbial part is said to be our microbiome.
So the microbiome are all the organisms that live in the human body, bacteria, fungi, viruses, protozoa. They're the organisms that live in and on us that make us home.
This relationship between bacteria and our human cells is one based on cooperation and collaboration. For thousands of years, this relationship has evolved. We provide a home, a habitat for the bacteria. In return, the bacteria in us and on us help provide security. Their importance in helping us function as humans should not be underestimated. Bacteria help regulate our metabolism, and they play an essential role in setting up our immune system.
We have grown up with our microbes over many, many generations. And in fact, we form what's called a symbiotic superorganism because we do things for each other. And those things are very important for the health of the total organism.
Okay, so the talk you heard earlier and last night was about the soil microbiome. Fantastic, amazing. And I've learned a lot in the talk today. And there's this comparison between what happens with the soil microbiome and what happens with birth, but I'll go into that in a little while. So the human microbiome is, so you have your human cells, so like your human component, and there's new science coming out, so it might not be 10 to 1, it might be, could be even as much as 100 to 1, or it could be 1 to 1 in terms of the ratio. All we know that there's, an estimated 10 trillion human cells, and there could be 10 trillion bacterial cells, or it could be 100 trillion bacterial cells, or it could even be 1,000 trillion cells. And because it all depends on what you eat and what your bacterial exposures are. Okay, so our body is human cells, and then you've got this ecosystem of bacteria and archaea and viruses and protozoa. So, I mean, we talked to our friends about it, and they're like, I don't get it, Toni. What are you saying? It's like, of course I'm not just a, you know, a mass of bacteria. It's like, well, you are, but they're so tiny that it's like if you put them all together, it would weigh the size of a human head. No, it's a human brain. I don't know if you've ever held a human brain, but it's about 3 pounds. Oh, gosh, kilos. Anyone kilos? 3 pounds? Two kilos, maybe. So that's and they're spread all around. So they're in your mouth. And if you go through your mouth, they go down your gastrointestinal tract, so down into your gut. And there's this gut-brain connection, which scientists are discovering. And we filmed a fantastic neuroscientist earlier this year talking about the brain, how the gut-brain are connected. So it's on your skin, it's in your lungs. So as you every breath you take, that big bacteria fill your lungs. If you're a woman, it's in your vagina. It's in your body is just coated on outside and inside with bacteria and viruses and everything else. And they keep our bodies functioning. They keep us healthy. When your body is functioning well and when your microbes are functioning well, you are healthy, ideally. And the most critical moment for our microbiome, our human microbiome, is birth. And then when the baby is born with natural vaginal birth, and I apologize, I'm going to use words like vagina and vaginal juices. I'm just going to have to go with it. So the baby, a woman goes into labor, and the baby is all snug in the womb. And as the baby starts to push on down to come out through the vagina, as soon as the waters break, so the amniotic sac surrounding the baby, as soon as that breaks, so the waters break, the baby starts being exposed to the world of bacteria and microbes and microorganisms. They start coating the baby. And because in the vagina, you have this special cocktail of microorganisms. The late stages of pregnancy, the mother's body changes. So you have a change in her microbiome in her breasts and in her vagina. And I can't remember the name, I think it's Bifido, I can't remember. I can't remember the actual species, but it changes your vaginal microbiome. So as that baby comes through the birth canal and the waters break, the baby will be coated in vaginal microbes, those microbes will go in its mouth, in its eyes, in its ears. The baby might swallow some of them. That's the main seeding event. That's the baby's first real exposure to microbiome. I wasn't here yesterday for your talk, but someone said that it was about, you know, that kind of an analogy of the baby being seeded at birth and the seeds being seeded when they start germinating, if I'm right. That's the moment. That is it. That moment. So when the baby comes out through the birth canal and is born, and it's an amazing, fantastic event, that baby is still acquiring all those microbes. Still kind of those microbes are going in its mouth, ears, skin, everywhere. and then when, hopefully, the baby will be put straight onto the mother's chest for immediate skin-to-skin contact. So then the baby gets more microbes, and because there's all these vaginal juices spread around, there's more microbes, and it's just swallowing it, wallowing it, coating in it. Fantastic. So then there's breastfeeding, and I'll show a clip before I get into the whole breastfeeding. Yes, so imagine that baby covered in those microbes. Okay. Okay, so I'm going to go back a little bit. So, you know, I said about being swallowed, coated in those microbes. When a baby is born vaginally, I don't know how to put this delicately. The baby might come into contact with fecal matter because as the baby comes out, there might be poo that's pushed out. And that's a good thing because it's exposure to those intestinal microbes as well. So you saw in the film that we filmed a beautiful water birth, beautiful, really kind of fantastic. And there's been no research into whether the kind of microbial transfers within water birth. There just hasn't been any research at all anywhere in the world. So this is my guess. So don't take this as gospel. This is my guess. I would think that if a baby is born in water, you might get a bit of intestinal gut flora because of if the mother poos in the birth pool. And probably because you've got, if the waters break and the baby's coming through the birth canal and those juices are all in the water, and because the baby has been in, depending on type of birth, the baby's been kind of through the birth process, would have been exposed to those microbes in the birth canal whilst in the water. And so your baby would have got some, sorry, I keep kind of pretending to give birth over here. So as the baby is coming through the birth canal into the water, it's going to pick up some of those microbes and those bacteria, and probably through the water, it's probably going to, again, this is my guess, going to pick up those microbes and plus those intestinal microbes from the poo. And then you get skin to skin. So you get skin to skin, the baby's going to get those more of those microbes. So one of the questions that often comes up is about, what about babies born in the cool, which is when the amniotic sac doesn't rupture. So the baby is born surrounded in that amniotic sac, maybe over its head, maybe over its whole body. I don't know if the midwives here might have seen babies born in the cool. So until that amniotic sac bursts, it's still in this near sterile environment. So as soon as that amniotic sac bursts open or is split open, that's when the baby starts acquiring microbes. So if the baby is born in the cool but is delivered onto the mother's abdomen, which is coated in all those vaginal juices and just that whole gush of water and messiness of birth, which is great. So as soon as, if the baby's born in the cool and then the amniotic sac is split open, while the baby is kind of on that kind of area, the upper thighs, the abdomen, everything, then that baby will probably, again, Toni hypothesis, no research on this at all anywhere in the world, would probably get all those microbes. I mean, I would love more studies to be done on this to find out babies in the born, what in microbial exposures happen. So then you've got the skin to skin with the mother, whether the baby's born with water birth or in the cool or vaginally. And then breastfeeding. And breastfeeding is amazing. Within breast milk, you have nutrition for the baby, you have immune components, but you also have antibodies. And then there's this thing called oligosaccharides, which are special sugars, carbohydrates, which are there to feed the baby's microbes that have just arrived in the baby's gut. So those special sugars are indigestible by the baby, but they are digestible by the baby's microbes. So it's the kind of seed and feed process. Seeding, vaginal birth, get all those schmaltzy bacteria covering every orifice, great. And then you have the breastfeeding, giving food to those microbes that have just been seeded in the baby's gut. So it's amazing. It's an incredible process. And scientists say that prolonged breastfeeding, I use the word prolonged, breastfeeding of a significant duration, maybe 6 months, 12 months, 18 months, is fantastic because the microbiome of breast milk changes over the first days, weeks, months, even years. It changes to be exactly the right food the baby needs over that time. Okay, so what happens if the baby isn't born vaginally? Or I'll talk about formula food actually at the moment. At the moment, I mean, formula is a choice, and it's fantastic it's there because it provides food, nutrition for the baby. But at the moment, it doesn't provide food for the baby's microbiome, the developing microbiome. I mean, there's some types of formula which are starting to add probiotics, but that's not uniquely designed for the mother's unique microbiome, because every single microbiome is different. So every single person in this room has a different gut microbiome. And that's because we've been born, we've been exposed to different things, we might have lived on a farm, might have lived in a city. So with formula milk, it just doesn't, right now, it's not unique enough to a mother's microbiome. So it might have nutrition for the baby, but doesn't have those immune components, doesn't have those right antibodies, doesn't have the food for the baby's developing microbiome. I'm not knocking formula, because I think it's vital to keep babies alive. But when you look at the science, I mean, you just see the kind of wonder of breastfeeding, the unique formulation of breastfeeding. Okay, let's talk about C-section, but I'll show you a clip first. I'm going to talk more about the swab seeding technique in a little while. Okay, so let's talk about C-section. The thing with vaginal birth and breastfeeding, the reason why it's so important that that happens is because the training of the immune system. So the first bacteria to arrive in the baby's gut trains the immune system to identify what's a pathogen and what's beneficial, what's good bacteria that should be tolerated and what's bad bacteria that should be attacked. So the immune system is set up for life at those critical first few hours and first few days. So it's all about this training of the immune system. So with a C-section, and I had a C-section myself with Willow, and it was she was breech, and then it was all sorts of complications, and it ended up being an emergency C-section in the end. So I don't know how familiar you are with C-sections. I'm just going to talk you through, in case though someone here doesn't know what a C-section is. So the mother is cut usually across their abdomen, lower abdomen about there, and the surgeon, so it's a lateral incision, and then the surgeon cuts through the wall of the, there might be a surgeon here, I don't know, so this is kind of my approximation, cuts through the wall of the womb to reveal the baby that's still in the amniotic sac, so still kind of surrounded by these membranes. So the surgeon will cut through those membranes and then lift the baby out through the abdomen, so through your lower abdomen. And then what usually happens is the baby is then checked by a neonatal specialist and passed to a nurse and the cord is cut, the baby's passed to a nurse, is taken to an assessment table, and the baby is weighed and measured and da-da-da-da. And it could be 10 minutes in traditional obstetric practice, could be 10 minutes, could even be 20 minutes before the baby is brought back to the mother. And in that time, that baby has been toweled off, so all that beautiful firmix on its skin has been rubbed off, it's been measured, it's been tagged. It might get eye, in America anyway, they give eye drops for some reason, I don't even know. Vitamin K injections might be injected. So this poor baby, within sort of 20 minutes of being born, has been prodded, been poked. Every single person who touches that baby is transferring microbes. The air from the operating theatre is going in that baby's mouth and lungs, because it's the first exposure to those bacteria. So if you may imagine that when that baby is returned to the mother, and if you're lucky, I mean, when Willow was returned to me, she was wrapped in a towel. There was no skin-to-skin contact. There was nothing. And, I mean, so you'd be lucky to get skin-to-skin contact with the mother. So for the first 20 minutes, maybe even first half hour, an hour, that baby is not getting any microbes, only those special microbes from the mother. I mean, there's a new type of caesarean which is just about sort of taking off now, which is called a natural caesarean, or a mother-centered caesarean, where the the screen is lowered, and so the baby is delivered straight onto the mother's chest. And the I can't think what it's called, the cannula in the mother's hand is put in the dominant hand to enable breastfeeding. So it's things that are starting to happen in night in obstetric practice. But in traditional caesareans, which are used in most hospitals all around the world, so the baby is brought back to the mother 20 minutes later, 10 minutes later, half an hour later. And then while the baby's sewn up, the baby might go to a recovery room, or the mother might go to a recovery room. In America, definitely, the baby's taken off to a nursery for assessment. All the time, those microbes from the air are kind of are seeding the baby's gut. So the baby's gut is still seeded, but not with the mother's vaginal special bacteria. And scientists are hypothesizing that this could be a problem for later life. And okay, there's several things with caesarean. There's antibiotics. Most mothers may receive a dose of antibiotics to ward off infection from just, you know, being opened up in an operating theatre, might receive antibiotics. Antibiotics impact the baby's microbiome, or the mother's microbiome, might impact her breast milk, might impact her gut microbiome, depending when the antibiotics were given. The baby bypasses the birth canal, so the baby doesn't get all those vaginal microbial content. The seeding, so the air of the operating theatre is filled with skin of people in the room. So it might be the mother, or it might be complete, you know, it could be us as filmmakers in there that might be seeding the baby's microbiome from random people, random strangers that are shedding skin every moment. That might be seeding the baby's microbiome. There's also the possible danger of pathogens. So if there's say, C. difficile within the air, I don't know if it's airborne, actually, C. difficile. Maybe it's on contact. But something within that operating theatre, some dangerous pathogen might also might get into that microbial mix in the baby's gut. And also C-sections impact a mother's ability to breastfeed. It just makes it more difficult for a mother to breastfeed just because the mother's usually pumped full of drugs, or she's going through the trauma of being cut open and then stitched up again and everything else. Okay, there's also something called epigenetics. So you have a potentially altered microbiome with babies born by C-section. With epigenetics, so there's scientists are starting to look at whether genes associated with vaginal birth. So vaginal birth could switch on or switch off certain genes, like a kind of sliding scale. So the process, the pressures and stresses of vaginal birth as the baby comes through the birth canal releases certain hormones, and it could cause epigenetic change, like beneficial epigenetic changes, just pushing through that birth canal might switch on certain genes that the baby needs for lifelong health. So if a baby is born by C-section, so it's brought out through the sunroof, that baby might not go through those stresses and be exposed to the same level of hormones that a vaginal baby would. So therefore, those genes that are supposed to be switched on or switched off with vaginal birth are not switched on or switched off. The baby doesn't know it's been born, so those epigenetic changes might not be happening. I mean, it's very, very early days, very, very early days. So this is just early indicators are that this could be the case. So there's this thing. Scientists keep saying to us, it's correlation, not causation. There's probably a lot of scientists in here. So correlation is about the link being made between caesarean and lifelong health outcomes. I'm not saying cesareans cause anything, because the research isn't there yet. There's a correlation. Maybe in a few years we'll find it does cause. There's a correlation, there's a link between babies born by C-section, and this could be because of an altered microbiome or epigenetic changes or something else that hasn't been discovered yet. But babies born by cesarean are at a 20% increased risk of certain conditions, 20% increased risk of asthma, 20% increased risk of becoming obese, 20% increased risk of type 1 diabetes, slightly low, I think it's about 16% increased risk of celiac disease. And there's massive, loads of studies all around the world which show this. It's very strong epidemiological evidence to say this is the case. Okay, so when somewhere like, I'm from the UK, and 800,000 babies are born each year in the UK. It's around 25% are born by cesarean. So 200,000 babies are born. Babies are born by cesarean a year. So this is what this comes from one of the scientists, and this is her data. So Dr. Nina Modi was looking at increased risk for obesity later in life if a child is born by cesarean. So she told us that if a baby is born vaginally, so you take 100 babies born vaginally, 60% are likely to grow up to be overweight or obese later in life. Quite a high statistic, that's just the way we live today. If a baby is born by C-section, 65 out of those 100 babies will be obese or overweight, according to her statistical analysis. So if you take 200,000 babies born by C-section, if those 200,000 babies were born vaginally, 120,000 of those would be overweight or obese. If we're looking at her 65% ratio, 130,000 of those 130,000 of those children born by C-section would become overweight or obese. So just each year in the UK, by Dr. Nina Modi's statistics, 10,000 children more a year are going to be obese or overweight later in life. And it's not just obesity, asthma, celiac disease and obesity. Dr. Rodney Dietert, the guy from Cornell, he's done research which shows that these diseases often are associated with other diseases later in life. So he's saying that these four diseases are actually just the tip of the iceberg. So there's increased risk of not just obesity, asthma, there's depression, there's bowel disorders, there's cardiovascular disorders, there's mental disorders. Some cancers are related to it sort of later in life. So there's this whole level of disease which could result just being born by C-section. And in the film, we talk about the World Economic Forum and the Harvard School of Public Health. They issued a report in 2011 that if we carry on the trajectory of non-communicable disease that we're on now, by 2030, they predict that this will cause the bankruptcy, or could cause the bankruptcy of our global healthcare systems. By 2030, that's 15 years from now, if we carry on the trajectory, if we don't make changes. And so if C-section is one of the contributing factors, we've got to make some changes. We've got to spread the word. Okay, I'm going to come to that in a bit. Okay, so what can we do? The positive stuff. Filmmakers like us, we make films. The film's being distributed internationally. I'm talking here today. So it's kind of, okay, spreading awareness of the film. If you haven't seen it, go to microbirth.com. You can stream it online. You can buy a DVD. And we're producing teaching tools. So we're producing a set of tools to be taught, hopefully by antenatal teachers all around the world. So that's what we're doing. We're also writing a book. We've been commissioned to write a book called The Microbiome Effect. That's coming out next year, which is really exciting. Okay, what else can we do? We can promote vaginal birth where possible. Caesareans are amazing and it's fantastic as it's a life-saving procedure. It can be. But if it's not necessary in certain situations, if it's elective caesarean, it would be lovely if we could promote awareness and education about the positive benefits of vaginal birth where possible, skin to skin and breastfeeding. The third thing, which I was talking about on the film, so swab seeding. This is research by Dr. Maria Gloria Dominguez-Bello from New York University. So she's looking at what happens if you, again, a little bit grim in terms of just go with it. So for a mother that needs to have a C-section, Dr. Bello's research is takes a tampon-type fan of material, inserts it into the vagina before surgery for an hour and incubates for an hour. So to pick up all those beautiful vaginal juices. And then just before surgery, that tampon of now filled with vaginal juices, those fantastic microbes, that gets put into a sterile container. The baby is cut open and delivered. And the swab is then wiped over the baby's mouth first, then over the baby's face, and then over the baby's body. So this is her research to basically expose that baby to those mother's vaginal microbes immediately. And her research is showing that babies who have this procedure, they reflect the microbiome of babies that are born vaginally. Now, I'm not saying that this is a solution. I'm saying that this is research that's currently ongoing. And the swab seeding technique for C-section babies doesn't account for those stresses and hormones that I talked about with epigenetic changes, because the baby is still going to be, might not undergo those processes. But by doing the swab seeding technique, that baby might be exposed to beneficial bacteria from the mother. And that could mean that the baby's microbiome isn't altered, which means that there could be lifelong benefits. There's all sorts of provisos with Dr. Maria Gloria Dominguez-Bello's research, in that her research is only into elective caesareans where there's non-emergency. And also, she doesn't do anything with group B strep. So group B strep is, I don't know the statistics in Germany, but in the UK, 25% of pregnant women have this group B strep bacteria in the body. And normally, it just sits there, fantastic. And babies born by a mother with group B strep, in most cases, it's absolutely fine. The baby grows up to be healthy. But there's a chance that the baby might contract a bacterial infection related to the group B strep. And if the baby does contract that infection, it's very serious. 1 in 10 babies die. So it's a very serious infection. So Dr. Bella's research doesn't include anybody with group B strep. Maybe within the next year, 2 years, 5 years, maybe there's some other sort of solution for mothers with group B strep. I hope so, because that's a high percentage. I mean, it could be more in other countries, a quarter of babies. Okay, so what else can we do? So we can talk about microbirth, watch microbirth, tell people to watch microbirth. We can promote vaginal birth. We can talk about Dr. Maria Gloria's Dominguez-Bello's. She's just published her preliminary research, and later this year, if not beginning of next year, she's doing her bigger study. So at the moment, she's just done a small sample, then her bigger study is going to be out, and hopefully that will rock the world, hopefully. And we can ensure proper microbial exposure from birth for definitely the first 2 or 3 years, because the baby's microbiome settles around age 2 to 3. It might even be slightly longer. New research is coming out that might be slightly longer where the baby's microbiome stabilizes. So breastfeeding, fantastic microbial exposures. You know, I'm a mother, and I know I was like probably helicopter mum with my antibacterial. This is before I knew antibacterial wipes, and you know, if when I got ill, I probably gave her antibiotics. So if possible, it'll be great if just this awareness that antibacterial products, get rid of them. Ah, this whole thing about kills 99.9% of all bacteria. Terrible. I mean, again, with a proviso, obviously, there's a deadly pathogen. Exposure to soil, exposure to good quality composted soil. Babies wallow in it, but roll around in it. Fantastic. Just to get that good quality microbial exposure. Breastfeeding, I talked about, of a significant duration. Eating foods. Okay, so our next film is looking at what you can do to protect and maintain your microbiome from birth throughout life. So birth, breastfeeding, getting those microbial exposures up until the microbiome stabilizes to around 2 or 3. And then what can you do from that onwards? We just got back from America yesterday, and we were filming people with debilitating illnesses. So we filmed someone with Parkinson's and someone with MS. So two case stories of people who got really, really sick. So the guy with Parkinson's, he's had it for 13 years. He was losing cognitive function. He was just shuffling around. He was really suffering with it. And the same goes for someone with MS. So a professor of medicine with MS, she lost the use of her whole left side. She was having, she called them zingers, for 2 to 3 weeks at a time. Her brain would just be just massive headaches, and she what else was she? She said that anything, like a touch of something, a fresh air, would set off these horrific pain all across her body. She ended up being in a zero gravity wheelchair, and so had to permanently spend her time kind of lying down with her legs in the air and couldn't move. And then she changed her diet. She to become more microbiome friendly, so eating fresh leafy green vegetables, sulfur rich vegetables. So you're So leafy green, kale, cabbage, green lettuce, sulfur-rich vegetables, onions, celery, what else? Mushrooms within, and then she did multicolored vegetables. So if you cut a vegetable, vegetables that are the same color all the way through. So if you cut a carrot, that stays orange all the way through. If you cut a butternut squash, it stays orange all the way through. So no peeling, all organic, and she also talks about she eats organ meat, so your kidneys, livers, hearts. She makes stock from the animal bones to get that bone marrow. So we filmed her this week. She's out of her wheelchair. She's walking around. She's back to work. She's got all her function. Everything is back again. Her mental clarity is much better. The guy with Parkinson wasn't following that diet, was following a similar paleo diet, just lots of vegetables, lots of kind of fresh organic meat, probably cows that eat good vegetables, good soil. So we filmed him mountain biking in the Rocky Mountains. That's where we were, in the Rocky Mountains, filming someone with Parkinson's, degenerative disease. He was secondary stage progressive Parkinson's. We were filming him mountain biking in the Rockies. We were filming him fly fishing. Beautiful, beautiful shot. I wish I could show you what we shot. So just fantastic. So you can restore your microbiome. You can turn your life around. It's not just, you don't have to have an illness. Just things like eating fermented vegetables. We came back from there going, right, that's it. We're going to start fermenting. We're going to eat a big your breakfast in the morning. Eat meat and eggs. I mean, they're saying steak and eggs for breakfast. No gluten, no dairy. I'm not saying you should do this. I'm just saying this is what they're doing, and it's changed them, and it's miraculous. We filmed someone else, and she was saying, "I am a miracle. I couldn't walk. I'd lost the use of one side." She lost the use of her hands. So there's someone with MS. She lost the use of her hands and couldn't move, couldn't work, couldn't function. She was spending $70,000 a month on medication for her MS. Now, no drugs, no medication. She just eats vegetables and organ meat. It's just fabulous. Okay, so that's our next film. I'm going to show you a little clip, if I can. Just of not the stuff we filmed the last week, stuff we filmed earlier this year. Okay.
Over the first days, weeks, months of life, we start acquiring our microbes.
Our microbiome doesn't really stabilize until we're 2 to 3 years old. By the time we hit 2 or 3, our microbiome starts to settle down, and then it's pretty stable until we get to about 60 or 70 years old.
The first 3 years of life is absolutely critical for the developing microbiome and for the developing immune system.
You need to get the exposure to the right kinds of bacteria under that age, under the age of 3. If it happens later than that, it may be too late to train your immune system to respond appropriately.
The greatest gift we could give to an infant for a healthy life course is really to ensure that those bacteria, those microbes, can inhabit the gut, respiratory tract, and other tissues that are designed to be there.
Any interruption during that period is likely to have lifelong consequences, both for the composition of the microbiome and for the child's developing immune system. So that's our best chance, actually, for both prevention and intervention to restore the healthy composition of the microbiome.
That baby's immune system needs to see those good bacteria. It needs to interact regularly with those good bacteria. And so if those are missing, that's a problem, and that can lead to later life disease.
Our internal ecosystem is degrading over time, generation after generation, that we're stepping down. Each generation is being born with less diversity than the one before it.
I think we have to reverse this trend urgently. I think all of the diseases of Western lifestyle that weren't prevalent a generation ago and that are becoming increasingly prevalent are going to be tied clearly to an influence of the microbiome.
This is a point of discovery. We are on a journey to understand this microbial world in the context of health and human well-being.
We use science to try to solve problems and to reach new solutions, and there's a lot of interest in the microbiome. And I'm hoping that that will lead to those new insights and new solutions.
Probably the most important thing that we can all do is to make sure that we teach children, teach the next generation about the importance of having a healthy microbiome and encourage the changes in that generation. That's where it's going to be most important.
One of the scientists there was Dr. Jack Gilbert. He said we're at a point of discovery. We were filming on an Amish farm and in Indiana, and it was beautiful. I mean, it's amazing. I've never been to such an amazing place, where the farmer had, it was an organic dairy farm, and he ploughed his he probably had really good soil. He ploughed his soil with horses, and I can't remember, these ploughs, and he had, I think it was 8 horses he ploughed the field with, and it was so beautiful. And all you heard was the tinkling of the ploughs and the harnesses from the horses. And his children, this farmer's children, and there were 6 kids, he saw a shot of them there in the dairy, and they were so healthy, and they interacted with cows. They even the teeny weeny ones, they were just kind of around, like the baby cows. Their microbes were really, really good. And the scientists were saying we've forgotten what it was like, how we used to live 100 years ago, how we used to have a close connection with nature, how we used to understand about soil and about compost and about how to give birth. And I don't know, I mean, but we can restore it. That's the point, is we're at the point of discovery, but we're also at the point of change. We can restore our microbiome. It's not just diet, it's lifestyle. So there's research about the positive benefits of exercise. So the Parkinson's guy I just talked about, the one mountain biking in the Rockies. So science has shown that exercise, like cycling, reduces Parkinson's by 35%. So he cycles every day, and that's the point. So he's changed his diet, he cycles. We can all get on a bike, we can all swim, we can all start running, you know, so it's stuff we can do. So change your diet, eat more veg, eat more fermented foods, eat organ meats, do more exercise, get a dog. There's research that getting a dog is just brilliant for your microbiome because it circulates. It's like a microbiome highway. So because they lick each other, they lick you, they dig in the ground, and that gets transferred to hopefully good soil. And so they sniff each other's bums, and it's all just the spreading those microbial fantastic bacteria. Open windows. I mean, we filmed in hospitals in America. Their windows don't open. They have built these buildings with windows that don't open. They don't understand. They're sealing in the kind of the pathogens. They're sealing in the harmful bacteria. So open your windows, but making sure that the air outside is not, I don't know, it's good air. If you open a window to bad air, I don't know. But good air, so good air, get a dog. Don't use your dishwasher, because your dishwasher will destroy, it makes everything too clean. Get dirty, that's my message. Just, we can make change happen by telling people to just communicate this information that we're living too clean, we're giving birth. The natural way is better, and we can learn from our grandparents. That's the point, is that the microbial, I'm coming back to the grandparents, because the scientists are discovering that it's transgenerational. So what my grandmother ate, how she lived, how she gave birth, her microbes from her gut microbiome get passed to my mother, who gave birth to me vaginally. So there's a direct kind of generation to generation to generation. And a mother's microbe, so if my mum gave birth to me vaginally, so I would have got her gut microbiome. And you pass it on for generation to generation to generation. And unless we make change now, our microbiome is degrading. So we've lost 35, you know, Dr. Dominguez-Bello, we've lost the 33%, a third of our microbiome. The bacterial diversity is degrading, it's gone. So unless we make changes, unless we get composting, unless we give birth, then, I don't know. I'm not going to say it's not too late, but we need to make change. Thank you.